I know many of us enjoy the Bob Newhart show, and particularly that zany guy who lives across the street. This is Kirk. This is Steve Kampman. And I want to know why you lie so much. Can't you ever tell the truth?
Why? It's so much nicer to lie. It makes life so much easier, you know, for everyone else.
But then you have to remember, you see, you get caught up in lies, and then they multiply, and then it gets hard to remember what the truth actually is.
I know, but think how unpleasant it is to hear the truth most of the time. And it's just, if you think you can avoid it for as long as possible, you know, it's very tempting. It's a tempting way of living.
I think I'm going to start living your way, because I like your way, because I find you very amusing.
Oh, great, thank you.
Can you tell me why the Bob Newhart show made it the first season when all the other shows around it fell by the wayside?
I think Bob Newhart, number one. I think because I think he's perfect for television. I think that the vehicle for him, setting it as in an inn and him as a writer. I think the public was ready for the return of a guy like Newhart. I should, you know, going back a bit, that, you know, that the comedies in the last few years really haven't been that terrific. And I think it was a welcome, it was like, welcome back, you know, it's good to see you. Oh, how nice. Someone's back who we know is funny and familiar. And I think that the writing was good, and I think that the cast generally has gelled well together. You know, I think it's a common, and we followed MASH.
Yeah. All those things that you say may be true, but they're wrong. You know why they're wrong?
Right. Why?
Do you know what made your show a success?
What?
Henry Mancini wrote the theme music. He wrote the theme music to each of the shows that was a success.
True.
Would I lie to you?
Well, I have to ask. Then that music, the music is terrific on the show, I think, don't you?
Yes, it's excellent.
Yeah, it's really a nice theme.
No, but it's just really odd. Of all the only shows that made it, he wrote the theme music. Isn't that funny?
I don't know the other shows that he wrote. I'm not going to.
I don't know either.
Well,
besides,
that doesn't
I might lie. And you wouldn't know.
That's right.
You know, we haven't really seen his face, but this guy's been behind the camera. He really has. And he was in the Second City in Chicago, in the Improv. He's a very funny man, and also used to write for WKRP in Cincinnati.
Yeah.
That was such a little jewel. I loved that show, and I was so sorry to see it go.
Yeah, it was, it was a good 4 years. It lasted 4 years. And it was a very funny show, and it was fun to work on. Mm-hmm. It was terrific. It was my first real big break, too, out here, so. It has a lot of good memories for me.
Did you work with the Second City Television before or after WKRP?
All my background really is in the Second City, in the theater end of things, as it were, in Chicago. And then I moved up to Toronto for 2 years.
Oh.
And the TV company is made up of the theatrical company, but it was already formed. They're an older generation than I am. They were ahead. They were in the, you know, the class ahead of me.
Are they a little more liberal? Are they allowed to get by with more things on
Canada.
Television than we are?
Yes, absolutely. It's late night. It airs when, you know, most people are deeply asleep. And so they get a few things in that you wouldn't see in prime time.
You're familiar with the Great White North.
Yeah, oh yes.
Some of the Canadians say that they think that's awful. Bob and Doug McKenzie, they just hate it.
They do.
But I think it's delightful.
Well, I'm a landed immigrant Canadian.
Oh, yeah.
You have to be in order to work up there. And Canadians hate that image, that they drink beer, that they're not very bright. They have a complex about being bordering on America. And most of them think that they're, you know, that they're inferior, that they're, or that they, that's how everyone views them. Americans view them as beer drinking kind of silly people. So they hate those guys doing that.
You know, at the Second City in Chicago, what happens, at least used to happen, I don't know whether it still does or not, after they do the little shtick and it's already prepared, then they say, okay, audience, you know, is there anything you'd like us to talk about, and we'll do an improv.
Yeah.
And then the audience will say, Nicaragua, or Israel, witches, whatever happens to be current. And then you take a topic.
Yeah.
And go back and take about, 10, 15 minutes?
Yeah.
And work up some bits. Can you recall some of the zaniest ones or some of the most offbeat?
Gosh, that's a good question. I can only remember, I mean, there are, I did over 1,600 shows, so you can remember, you can imagine trying to remember all the improvs. And I should say that from those improvs that you're talking about, that the audience suggest, and we go back and make up little scenes and come out and do it in front of the audience, they make up the material for the new show. So you're always building the new show to come.
Oh, hey, that's very utilitarian. Certainly.
Yeah, so that's how the audience is very involved in what will be the next show. In terms of pieces, it's really hard to say what was the zaniest or the craziest. I think the craziest, yes, I do. I know what the craziest piece was. It was a piece that I won't go into too much detail about. It was just a very weird piece set to a piece of music that was very weird, and the audience thought that the piece was probably in bad taste and not very attractive, and at the end of the piece the lights went down, and how do I put this nice, the entire the system from upstairs, you know, it was a dinner theater, so the theater was downstairs, and all the toilets and johns began flooding and directly falling on top of the audience right at the end of the piece. So apparently that's the piece was in such bad taste that literally they had to actually leave the room. They had to go out. I'm not going to go into what the piece was about because it won't ever get on
this. Now, is this the truth or are you lying?
It's no, it's actually true that the whole place became flooded.
Okay.
With, that's true.
Okay, hey, listen, I'm delighted to meet you. Newhart is a funny, funny show. His comedy timing is terrific. What a nice opportunity for you.
What a pleasure to meet you.
Thank you. Steve Kampman is his name. He's on the Bob Newhart Show. We like him very much. Please, stay with us till 11 Morning continues.
You're not lying.